Tonight, just by way of refresher, then just want to remind you what we were looking at in this study about reasons for sickness. We looked at personal sin, and there are two specific occasions where Jesus said the reason someone was sick was personal sin. And then we looked at the sins of the forefathers and God sending sickness and diseases on the children of the third and fourth generation. We looked at Job about the test of your faith. We saw Epaphroditus about the misuse of God's temple. And again, I'll remind you that this is probably the one that has the weakest evidence as far as scriptural evidence. But it's one that most people have personally experienced, so they don't have too much trouble understanding the reality of that. So, we saw a man who was born blind, and the disciples said, "Hey, Jesus, who sent this man or his parents that he would be born blind?" And I used to say, "Oh, what a bunch of idiots." And actually, they weren't at all. They said, "Jesus, is this man sick because of cause number one, personal sin? Or is he sick because of cause number two, the sins of the forefathers, and being passed down to him?" And in that case, Jesus said, "Neither one. This guy's sick because on this case, in the case, and I call it a sickness, but blindness, an ailment, a physical malady, was so that on that particular day when Jesus came by, that the blind man would be made well and that God would be glorified." We went and looked at Paul, and we saw that Paul had this thorn or demon. He actually came right outside, an angel of Satan in his flesh to keep him from sin. We don't know exactly how it manifested, but there are some hints at that in the scripture, and really that's beside the point. The point was that it was to keep him from getting puffed up with pride, which would have been sin, which would have interfered in his relationship with God. So tonight we want to start on cause number 7. We're going to look at 7, 8, 9. We want to start in Ezekiel. So if you want to go Isaiah, Jeremiah, who wrote Lamentations, Ezekiel and Daniel, that's where we're going to be. Ezekiel 14th chapter. Ezekiel chapter 14. While you're going there, I want to mention that I placed some of these cards on the table. I hope you will split them up with the people that are there. On one side is the website where you can go see about 70 or so Bible teaching sessions on YouTube. And on the back side is the church's website where you can see some of the some of our meetings. You can see some of the testimonies. We've got some of those uploaded. On the church's website, it's a little bit harder to navigate. You need to click on sermons, and it's not all sermons under that category, but it's each Sunday's meeting. And Norm's testimony is in there, Bob's testimony is in there, Rose's testimony is in there, and Jack's testimony is in there, and you have a chance to go and hear what they shared in front of the congregation there too. So take those with you and pass them out. I do want to point out one typo. If you're giving this to somebody and you tell them to come to the windmill, and you look at the address there, and you have to have your magnifiers, 1140 East Butte. And if you go to 1140 East Butte, you know where you'll be? Arizona State Prison. Okay? A little typo will get fixed eventually. It's 1140 West Butte. Follow the sunset. And the yellow brick road. But I encourage you to take those with you, please. We have a bunch of these have been printed up. Take them and leave them accidentally on dining tables at restaurants and give them out. Who knows? Michael, do we know about how many different countries people have gone to the website from now? Do you remember?
About 17, I think.
17 countries?
Yeah.
Oh, the last I knew it was 7.
Yeah.
Because I knew there was New Zealand and Spain.
A lot of Asian countries popped up.
A lot of Asian countries. Yeah. Now, is that in part because if they turn, because they're picking up some words from the closed captioning? Or?
Possibly, yeah, possibly.
That may be part of the reason why. How many different?
We started closed captioning, and it's happened about maybe 15 videos ago. It's something YouTube's been doing automatically. I'm going to have to go with the first earlier videos and re-upload them again so they can do that again.
Okay.
But we have been getting some hits from the closed captioning, I think.
Mm-hmm. We were over 1,000 or so before. Do we know
how many views in total?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you have to count that some views were just only a few seconds.
Right.
But there's about 10,000 views total.
How many?
10,000.
Well, the last time I asked it was 1,000, so yeah. That was about 4 or 5 months ago. So,
yeah.
You know, who knows what the Lord may do with this? It's just an amazing thing. Just because the enemy takes something like the internet to do evil things with it, doesn't keep God from using it for His glory. And so how about that? Over 10,000 views. So praise the Lord. And the interesting thing is that now that it's out there, it can be out there until Jesus comes again. And until He gives us more revelation, we have to come back and say, grace, you know.
Yeah.
But you see, you understand that when we share here, I'm not sharing from the perspective that I've got all the answers. I'm sharing from the perspective of, here's what we're seeing now. Let's continue to pursue more and more truth. And that's where we're going to be going. Well, thanks, Michael, for sharing that with us here. That's awesome. So leave them around. Who knows? People may stumble into something, and that's wonderful to know that God's touching people out there. In Ezekiel 14, starting in verse 6, we're going to... by the way, the reason that I get more scripture on this one is because this one really grates against us. How can I be sick because I participate in what someone else did? Well, that's a good question. I'm glad you asked that. That bothers us as Americans. But you know what? Let's look and see. Ezekiel 14, verse 6. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, repent, turn away from your idols, and turn your faces away from all your abominations. For anyone of the house of Israel or the immigrants who stay in Israel, who separates himself from me, sets up idols in his heart. Remember, I've mentioned the lady that when we ask her about idols in her heart, in fact, I think it may be the only time I've ever asked that question of anyone. And the problem was her china collection. That if she was feeling depressed, she would go stand in front of it and feel better. God wants us to come stand before Him if we're having a problem and seek Him. But anyway, that was one of the things that this came from, idols in your heart. Puts right before His face the stumbling block of His iniquity, and then He comes to the prophet and inquires of me for Himself. I, the Lord, will be brought to answer him in my own person. And I shall set my face against that man and make him a sign and a proverb, and I shall cut him off from among my people so you'll know that I am the Lord. But if the prophet is prevailed upon to speak a word, it is I, the Lord, who have prevailed upon that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand against him and destroy him from among my people Israel, and they will bear the punishment of their iniquity. Listen to this. As the iniquity of the inquirer is, so the iniquity of the prophet will be. See, somebody comes and says, hey, I need an answer from God, and they've got idols in their heart. God says, I'm going to answer them. I'll tell you what to say to them. But if you're prevailed on to say something, see, this is exactly the problem that Balaam got into. God already gave an answer, and then he was like, let me check. Let me see if God will change his mind here. And you know what? God said, sure, go ahead. And God would have struck him dead if his donkey hadn't saved his life. So the prophet then becomes, he says, the punishment for their iniquity is not only going to be on them, it's going to be on the prophet as well. And we know, to extrapolate from that, like in King Asa's case, because of his sin, he became sick. And so if a prophet was complicit with him in that, what would happen? Same thing could potentially happen there too. So this is a little bit disconcerting and unsettling, and as it should be. Okay? As it should be. Let's go now to 1 Timothy 5. Now, and you need to understand the whole context of 1 Timothy 5. In 1 Timothy 5, Paul is giving instruction to Timothy, who's a young pastor, and he's laying out some guidelines for peaceful, unified, functioning, appropriate in the congregation. For example, in verse 1, which isn't on your list, but 1 Timothy 5:1, do not sharply rebuke an older man, but rather appeal to him as a father, to younger men as brothers, to older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters in all purity. Honor the widows who are widows indeed. And he goes on from there with some other descriptions. So he's talking about the orderly functioning of the body of Christ as they gather together. And then he gets on down here in verse 17. And he says, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. which actually has to do with honorarium. And he says, especially those who work hard at preaching and teaching. You know, Paul said he had the right, if he sowed spiritual things among you, to reap material things from you. But on several occasions, he didn't exercise that right. The last church where I was pastor in Colorado, I was pastor there for about 7 years. And finally, in the last year, they decided they should probably help offset some of our costs and what we were doing. Most of that went to meals and fellowshipping with people and stuff. But you see, sometimes it's right to not exercise that. And that's what he's actually talking about right here. That the elders who rule well are worthy of double honor. And then he says, the scripture says, don't muzzle the ox while he's threshing. And the laborer is worthy of his hire. And then he says, don't receive an accusation against an elder except on the basis of two or three witnesses. And so these guidelines are significant. We're not going, I mean, we could go off and study about that. And at some point we will look at order from 1 Corinthians 12 and 14 especially, and some of the guidelines about orderliness among God's people. But he warns and says, don't take an accusation against an elder. And he draws the parallel there about an ox doing threshing. You know that what he's talking about is when you bring in the grain is attached to the stalk, the grain has to be separated because the grain is what you want. You don't want to mix the stalk in there that's stringy and has very little nutritional value and all that. And so you do this beating process. And in the old days, they would put an ox and he would walk in a circle on them. You know what they do? Did I tell you what they do in India? Oh, yes, yes, yes. You want to know about that, right? In India, in the rural areas, when they go out by hand with a sickle and they cut down the crops and they're doing the threshing, they put it on paved roads. The cars and the trucks and everything drive over it. And pressure is exerted, which is necessary for threshing to take place. Pressure is exerted and the grain is separated from the stalk. Then they come along and throw it up in the air, and just like in the old days, the breeze carries the stalk away and the grain falls back down. So you have to be careful. We had a 16-hour taxi cab ride to go from the southeastern tip on the Indian Ocean, where we'd been teaching, we're sleeping on the beach and teaching in the villages, and we were going all the way across to Bombay, which is now Mumbai. In a few months, it might be something different. Who knows? You know, they are changing these names. We're making that trip. We come around a corner, and right in the middle of the highway is this pile of grain that's about 8 or 9 feet high, and it covered the whole road. So they've been doing the thrashing, throwing it up in the air, sweeping it together, and the cars had to go off the road to get it up. You know, wouldn't you love that call into the insurance company? Hey, hello there, farmers. I had a head-on collision with a pile of grain. No, it was right in the middle of U.S. Highway 60, right there in the middle of the road. Well, that's just the way they do it out here, you know, we're a little backwards. So you have those big piles of grain. You see, pressure has to be exerted for threshing to take place. And Paul compares the preaching and teaching of God's word as threshing. And there's pressure. You know what happens when pressure gets exerted on some people? They complain about it. I got the biggest kick out of it today. There was someone who came to the musical thing this weekend, and they've been to a couple of meetings. And he told somebody what they thought of their pastor. I can't stand the guy! Yeah. I can't stand the guy! Been there twice! I can't stand him! But you see, when you're speaking God's word, it puts pressure on the heart. And a lot of times what happens is people come back with complaints and ought against the messenger. That's why the rule that God gave is don't receive an accusation against someone who's a leader except on the basis of two or three witnesses.
So you're saying preaching is kind of like being run over by a car?
That's pretty close to it. So sit back and lay down flat. Oh! So you see the context of what he's talking about. Okay, we're going somewhere here that actually does have to do with healing. So, by the way, when somebody makes a statement like that, I go, Lord, You got a Lord, you got a problem. These are your people. You deal with it. I'm just going to keep speaking God's word as He guides me here. So you don't receive an accusation except on the basis of two or three witnesses. By the way, those who continue in sin, listen. Rebuke in the presence of all so that the rest may be fearful of sinning. Now, do you understand? This is the different standard I keep talking about for the leaders in the churches. There is a... If someone in the congregation is in some blatant public sin and needs to be dealt with, the Bible says you go to them privately and hopefully they'll repent. If they don't, you take two or three witnesses. And then if they still won't change their ways, then you tell it to the congregation. Not so with the leaders. That's why when you read about what Paul did in reference to Peter, he said, you know, Peter started withholding himself from the Gentiles because the big shots from headquarters had shown up and he didn't want to be seen associating with the Gentiles because they thought the Gentiles were the scum of the earth and the dregs and you would be defiled if you're related to them. They certainly couldn't be going to heaven to be God's people. So he withdrew. So Paul rebuked Peter publicly. He did not go to him privately. Why? Because he's a leader and that's what Paul is instructing Timothy to do in relation to the leaders in the church. Those who continue in sin, rebuke in the presence of all, so the rest may be fearful of sin. I just thought I would point that out to you in case, well, most of us are very ignorant about church discipline. Three times that I have had to exercise my responsibility in church discipline, and in all occasions, people got mad and left the church. But it's what Scripture says to do. That's the way it is. And by the way, some of them went away saying that wasn't, you were so mean to that woman, why didn't you go to her privately? Excuse me, we did. Here are the men that went with me the next time. I asked them, they were there. But you see, when people already are feeling the pressure of the threshing that's going on, of teaching God's word, it strikes sometimes. It strikes at things that we used to hold to and think that were true, and we find out they're not, and sometimes it really ticks us off. Next Sunday... This coming Sunday, Christmas Day, I'm going to share about myths about Christmas. And I do that with a little bit of trepidation because the first time I did this, I was pastoring Klamath Falls, Oregon. And a man who had grown up in the church, who was in his late 20s, married man, came to me and he was red in the face, angry at me. He said, "You have completely ruined Christmas for me. I'll never come back here." Oh, and he never did. Because, I don't know if he wanted the animals talking or the drummer boy there or, you know, what these other things were. But you know, that's why I say I don't get any joy about chasing anybody off. But it is a responsibility to speak God's truth. All right, we're finally getting down to the subject at hand here. So he says, in verse 21, "I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and Jesus Christ and of His chosen angels to maintain these principles without bias. Doing nothing in a spirit of partiality." Oh, he's my friend. He gets a pass. I don't like that guy. So, boy, I'm going to rain all the fire and brimstone I can on him. I said, no. Nothing out of partiality. "Do not lay hands upon anyone too hastily and thus share responsibility for the sins of others." Now, first thing you think of is laying hands on people who are ill that we're praying for them to be healed. That's not what this is talking about. You see the context of this? The whole thing is about the leadership and organization and the unity in the body. This is not about praying for sick people. This is about laying hands on people and setting them up as apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers, deacons, elders, leaders in the congregation. Okay? That's what he's talking about when he says laying hands on. "Do not lay hands upon anyone too hastily and thus share responsibility for the sins of others. Keep yourself free from sin." And then Paul completely forgets what he's talking about and throws this in. "No longer drink water exclusively, but a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments."
I love
that. And yeah, you love that. And then Paul remembers what he was talking about and he gets back on the subject and said, "The sins of some men are quite evident, going before them to judgment. For others, their sins follow after." Did Paul lose his train of thought? Of course he didn't. The Holy Spirit was guiding him what he was saying. Then why in the middle of this discourse about not laying hands on any and setting them up as leaders too hastily, does he throw in the thing about Timothy having frequent stomach problems and said, you might as well take some wine for your stomach ailment? Why did he throw that in the middle?
To tie them together.
Yeah, exactly. Timothy had done the very thing he was warning him not to do anymore. And what Paul was saying is, God's not going to heal you of your stomach ailments yet until you learn your lesson and not set up people too hastily as leaders, and then they wind up driving the congregation away. Two times in churches that I've been a part of, one I had nothing to do with, where the day the guy showed up in the body, they made him an elder. Why would anybody do that? Well, he was a pastor at another place. So as soon as he shows up, boom. But you see, the Bible says you don't do that. And it's amazing how when you see God doing things among you, you can begin to get a little presumptuous about, hey, this is what we think we should do. It must be okay because God's with us. You see, God disseminates His guidelines without partiality. And we're all expected to go by it. And by the way, there is no church in that place anymore because the man that they set up as a leader too hastily. A second time, I was the one who did it. And I got deceived. And we set him up on the staff in the church that I was in. And he began to undermine what the Lord was doing and did everything that he could to actually see that I went out of the church and he could take over the church. And some of the people have never recovered from that. And by the way, I had to leave and they're back to their 12, 14 people like they used to have before we started having 180, 200 people. I blew it. And I repent. Trying to be wise about that and discerning. In Timothy's case, he got stomach problems. And see, it used to be I'd point to this and say, see, Timothy had stomach problems, and Paul told him to take some wine. That'll help settle your stomach. So see, God doesn't heal anymore. Actually, no, that's not it. God's not going to heal until Timothy learns his lesson. Do you remember what God did with Miriam when she was struck with leprosy for she and her brother conspiring against Moses? They prayed. Moses prayed and said, God, heal her. God said, well, I will, but not yet. I'm going to give her 7 days with this life-threatening disease before I heal her. And so in his case, the same thing was true. Can I prove that Timothy got over his stomach problems? Not specifically about Timothy, but as the general policy of what we see God doing. Look how he dealt with Hezekiah. You're going to die, get your house in order. And he cries out to God, and God adds 15 years to his life. Asa gets mad at God and the prophet who delivered the message. He throws him in jail, and over three years he gets diseased. The disease gets worse. God's trying to get a hold of his heart, and he won't repent. And the Bible says he went to the doctors, he wouldn't seek the Lord, and so he died 3 years later. You see, we see these principles of how God deals in discipline. By the way, notice this isn't in the world in general. These are people who claim to be his people. Timothy was a servant of the Lord. But Timothy messed up. God used a physical ailment to teach him a lesson. And in this case, you wind up sharing in the sins of other people that lead people astray. They lead them into darkness, they lead them into the ditch, or perhaps they even separate them so they want nothing to do with a walk with God anymore. No, Paul did not lose his train of thought. No longer drink water exclusively, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. And then he said, the sins of some men are evident going before. Some people, their sin is just blatant right out front. But for others, when you meet them, they look good. That's why, again, even this week, I warned the people at Queen Valley. I said, you need to be on guard. Am I a false prophet? The only way you're going to know is for us to spend some time walking together. Okay? Be on guard. Listen for the voice of the Lord. look for fruit. All of these things that Jesus indicates we should do as we look at one another. Not in spewing judgment and condemnation on each other, but just being on guard that we don't get led astray. And so, in this case, he said, some men, their sin's right out front. Others, it's hidden and disguised, and they gloss it over really well. But after a while, you find out what's really hidden in their hearts. And it's going to come out. By the way, what's in the heart is going to come out at some point. The Lord will expose that. Let's go to Revelation 2. So Timothy had been guilty of sharing in the sins of others. And he had an ailment. It wasn't life-threatening, but he had an ailment. And God used that to get a hold of his heart. Revelation chapter 2, verse 20. He's talking to the angel of the church in Thyatira, and he writes this. By the way, verse 19, Jesus said of the church here, your deeds of late are greater than at first. That's a compliment. Praise the Lord for that. Their deeds of late are greater than at first. Wow. That is powerful. These are people who are really walking with God, but there's a problem in the church. But you need to understand, this is not some bizarre group that's, you know, meeting way out in the desert somewhere and wall themselves off from the world and they have all kinds of strange practices. These are people that Jesus said, your deeds of late are greater than at first. That's a compliment. So understanding what this problem is he's about to identify, we need to understand that it's something that is hidden and very subversive that cannot be seen and noticed right on the surface. They're not blatantly going out and doing something in disobedience and rebellion to God. So this is what makes this particularly egregious here. Verse 20, but I have this against you, that you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. Are there prophetesses in Scripture? Nod your head, wag it. Yes, 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 there are. Anna was in the temple praising and worshiping and serving God. And when she saw Jesus, when they brought him in, she rejoiced and said, boy, now I've seen the Messiah. I'm ready to go home. She was a prophetess. Deborah was a prophetess. There are many examples of prophetesses in Scripture. So that's not the problem. But here's the problem. She teaches and leads my bondservants astray. Now, in teaching and leading, by the way, the Bible says that the women are to teach the younger women about walking with God, being godly in their relationships and their family. That's what they're supposed to be doing. They're not supposed to be leading, teaching authorities over men. Scripture says that. And that really bothers Americans today. And, you know, as Hillary said, that's some of that old-fashioned stuff that needs to be rid of. Really? I think we're going to follow right after them, right? But you know, we need to understand what the Scripture says about this. Listen, what does she cause them to do? She causes them to commit acts of immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. Now, this is really a conundrum here. These people's deeds of late are greater than at first. All right? So what kind of immorality are we talking about here? We're talking about spiritual immorality. People whose deeds of late are greater than at first aren't out there fornicating and getting into adultery and all of this kind of stuff. That's not what's happening. It's spiritual adultery. And you remember we've seen in Romans 6, 7, and 8, Paul describes for us the condition, the desperate condition of a person who's in spiritual adultery. Some of you didn't get to be in on this study that we did a few months ago, but when Paul says the thing I want to do, I don't do, I do the very thing I hate, he's talking about the person who's in spiritual adultery. All of us, because of our inherited nature, are married to this world system. We come along and we hear about Jesus, that we can be forgiven of our sins and our failings, and that we can have eternal life with Him, and that eternal life starts right here in this world. It doesn't start later, it starts now. And we say, hey, I want to be married to Jesus. But you see, your flesh nature is still married to this world. That's spiritual adultery. And it's described in Romans chapter 7, the first part of it. Because you're married to the world, and you want to be married to Jesus. Romans 7 is a description of a person in this place. And that's why he goes on to say, he finally says, I'm so desperate. Who will set me free from this body, the body of this death? He didn't stop there. Romans chapter 8 came, and he talks about how you die to your fleshly nature so that you're not in spiritual adultery. You're totally married to and devoted to Jesus Christ. And that's where you come into the place of joy and peace. So in her teaching, she's teaching something that's telling people it's fine to walk, talk, and act like the world, but you're still going to go to heaven. You're getting this spiritual adultery thing. It doesn't give us the specifics. It simply refers to it. And then the other thing that's a little bit troubling is eating things sacrificed to idols. Because you know what Paul said about that? He said, I can eat things sacrificed to idols. And idols, nothing. But if it's going to cause somebody to stumble, I won't do it. In fact, he went on, he said, I will not eat meat or drink wine or do anything if it's a hindrance or causes my brother to stumble. Because I'm going to walk in love. So, you know, if I have a Seventh-day Adventist friend and I'm inviting him over to eat, I'm not going to make pork chops. Why is that? Because they consider that a sin. So I wouldn't do it. Is it a sin? No. All things are clean. The Bible says so. Paul came right out and said, everything's clean, but to the one who eats with the intent of giving offense, to him it's sin. Don't do it.
Amen. Okay, well, so we have this freedom, which the Bible makes clear. But my question is when, if we're taking advantage of that freedom, do we wait till we offend someone?
Well, a key in that is about the offense that we give. That's the what we're warned about in the Scripture.
Better to be on the safe side than the wrong.
Yeah, sure. And that, you know, and Jesus is going to be your Lord and lead you and all that. So this woman who's exercising authority in this church is causing people to be in spiritual immorality and eating things sacrificed to idols. And there's a whole interesting study we can do about that. But let's press on so you get to the greater point here. Verse 21. I gave her time to repent. She does not want to repent of her immorality. Spiritual immorality. A lot of people think there was a woman literally by the name of Jezebel who was in this church. And Jesus was calling her by name. I'm going to show you in your Bible that that is not the case. All we have to do is keep reading, and you're going to find out that this Jezebel thing is a teaching. It is a mode of conduct that's ungodly. It's not literally a woman named Jezebel. And it's right here in your Bible. Just hang on. We're going to see it. He says, behold, I will cast her upon a bed of sickness, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation. Oh, they were committing physical adultery with her. No, sir, remember? Their deeds of late are greater than at first. It's not that she's sleeping with a bunch of people in the church. She is teaching them that spiritual adultery is okay, and it's not okay because God's calling us to a higher place. And he says, those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, listen, unless they repent of her deeds. Now, there's a question on exact translation there, because some translations say, unless they repent of their deeds. Some translations say they repent of her deeds. It is not clear in the Greek which it is. But it really doesn't matter either way, because they are participating in allowing her to continue on in this teaching that she's doing. Okay, now he's not done yet. And Jesus says, I'll kill her children with pestilence. That's sickness, disease, all kinds of things that we read about and the curses of the law and so forth. And he says, and all the churches will know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts, and I will give to each of you according to your deeds. Isn't that interesting? I'll give to each of you according to your deeds. It's amazing to me how many times I find this right here in the Bible, that I will give to each of you according to your deeds. Jesus talked about the resurrection. Those who did the good deeds, the resurrection of life. And those who did the evil deeds, the resurrection of judgment. And yet, how many of us have heard in how many churches that it doesn't matter about our actions, it's just ask Jesus in your heart. Or speak in tongues. Or get baptized physically in the water. Or there are all these variant teachings. They're all over the map. But the reality is, the Bible says, those who walk with Jesus are going to do the good deeds. We're going to do the deeds of Jesus. And that's what he says here, that I'm going to give to you according to your deeds. And then he says this. Okay, we're not quite through. Don't miss this part, because this is going to help you understand that I'm, you know, not nuts here about this. It's right here in the Scripture in what Jesus said. Verse 24. But I say to you, the rest who are in Thyatira, listen now, who do not hold this teaching. What teaching? The Jezebel teaching. See, it's not a woman named Jezebel, but it's a teaching that has happened in the church in Thyatira, whose deeds of late are greater than at first. Those who do not hold this teaching. Now, hold on, Jesus is going to tell us something that's kind of mind-blowing. Who have not known the deep things of Satan as they call them. Say, what? All right. In this church, their deeds of late are greater than at first. But they've let something very seductive that looks okay and seems spiritually right, they've let it come in to the church. And now people are living in spiritual adultery and think that it's okay because this deceptive teaching has come in. And Jesus said, those of you who do not hold this teaching, who've not known the deep things of Satan as they call them. The question I have is, if I can use a little grammatical term here, what is the antecedent to the they? The they who are calling this the deep things of Satan. Who is it Jesus is referring to that call this Jezebel spirit and this Jezebel practice? Who is it that is calling this Jezebel thing the deep things of Satan? Now see, I know it's not the people in the church. Not this church of Thyatira. The reason I know it's not them is because their deeds of late are greater than at first. They're on the right path. They're walking in the right direction. And Jesus said this thing is called the deep things of Satan. Who's calling it that? It's not the people in the church. It's the powers of darkness. That it's so seductive and it's so deceptive that the powers of darkness say this is one of the deep things of Satan. And it's a tool they're using to destroy God's people. Yes, ma'am?
In this, the Hebrew one that I've got, it says...
In which verse?
In 24. But to rest... But to the rest of you in Thyatira, who do not hold to this teaching and have not learned the so-called deep things of Satan.
Okay. So-called deep things of Satan. Who's calling it the deep things of Satan? It's our enemy that's calling that the deep things of Satan, because here is this church that's doing a lot of right things. There are people who are really walking with God, but they sneak this thing in.
That's how they seduce young kids into witchcraft.
And in this case, the Jezebel thing is the deep things of Satan. So you want to know, well, what about this Jezebel thing? Well, you know, God devoted several chapters to telling us about Ahab and Jezebel. It might behoove us to go back and see what the problem was with Ahab and Jezebel.
Go to in the OT, that's physical.
They're physically happening back there, illustrating, that's right, illustrating for us. And remember what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 10, he said, all of those things happen to them and are written for our instruction upon whom the ends of the ages have come. And he talks about the manna from heaven being a picture of the way God feeds us with the bread of life. Everything that physically happened to them was illustrative of and demonstrating for us spiritual truths. I want you to notice that pestilence and sickness is going to come on people that keep walking in this way. Why? Because they share in the sin of the one who is leading God's people astray right there in the congregation. Again, the point tonight is just for you again to see people being sick by sharing in someone else's sin and not taking a stand against it. And by the way, there are many more illustrations of this. I do want to go to one more because it's just really clear. when we go to Revelation 18. But I just want to mention one illustration. You remember the priest Eli? Remember Eli? He had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And God brought Samuel on the scene. You remember the woman was crying out to God. She was barren and she wanted a child. And she said, God, if you will give me a son, I will dedicate him to you. And she went home, and a year later she comes back and brings the son and presents him to Eli. And Samuel grew up and he became a powerful prophet of God, full of the Holy Spirit. Amazing things that God did through Samuel. And in that case, do you remember what happened to Eli? Because he wouldn't correct his sons. On the day that his sons died, because God brought about their death in a battle, Eli fell off the place he was sitting, broke his neck, and he died at the same time with his sons. Did he get physically sick? No, but he did die. So that might be a little worse than getting physically sick. That's about turning. So there are lots more illustrations of this, but I just picked out on these. While you're there, go to Revelation 18. Revelation 18, verse 1 says, after these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And in verse 2, Revelation 18, he cried out with a mighty voice. Oh, by the way, I just do want to mention, notice there is no S at the end of Revelation. It's not multiple revelations cumulatively. All of this is one singular revelation. Just a little finer point. Because if you're sharing with people and you say, well, go to Revelations, whatever, and they go, you know, you haven't been reading your Bible very carefully. I don't know if I should. You know, it's little things that people pick on. So I just wanted to mention that to you. He cried with a mighty voice in verse 2. Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling place of demons and a prison of every unclean spirit and a prison of every unclean and hateful bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the passion of her immorality. Now here it is again. Are they saying that sexual immorality is okay? No, but it's spiritual immorality. And I just have to tell you that most American churches are teaching their people that spiritual immorality is okay. You can walk, talk, and act like the devil and be married to the world. God understands, after all, you're only human. But as long as you claim to be holding the hand of Jesus, you're going to go to heaven. That is not what the Bible says. The Bible says, that's why Jesus said, if you're going to walk with me, you have to take up your cross every day. You have to crucify the fleshly nature that wants to be married to this world system. That's what God's calling us to. And so here she is. By the way, this is a church. This woman here that he's describing is a church. You remember, Jesus is the groom. The church is the bride. The bride becomes the mother and gives birth to offspring. Okay, so she's the woman, she's the mother, she's the bride. She's become a dwelling place of demons, verse 2, a prison of every unclean spirit, a prison of every unclean and hateful bird. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the passion of her immorality. And the kings of the earth have committed acts of immorality with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich by the wealth of her sensuality. Isn't it interesting that a lot of the world's leaders love certain kinds of churches? You know that Hitler was making a move in Germany to take over the German church. And as I talked to you a couple years ago about one of my heroes, one of the men that I just admire and I look forward to shaking his hand someday, was Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was in America, could have stayed away from the whole mess in Germany of what happened and what the people there were subjected to. Most of the people in Germany were not Nazis. Those of you, you need to get your history straight, you know. You need to understand, I've met a few of those people and the horrible things they were doing to their own people. And there was no way for them to fight back. Well, part of the reason they couldn't fight back, you know, was one of the first things Hitler did? Confiscated all the private weapons from all the citizens. Isn't that interesting? Oh, no, no, gun, taking guns up, that's all for your own benefit. I mean, this is just for your own safety. But anyway, that's an aside. We won't go pursuing the Second Amendment thing. But you need to understand, he was here in America, and he was offered a nice position to be teaching theology in Chicago, and he went back to Germany because he believed God wanted him to help kill Hitler. One of the most godly, most insightful young men of the 1930s. And Hitler saw to it, and even though some of his family were involved in the Valkyrie thing, the attempt to kill Hitler, The bomb actually tore his trousers and everything, but he escaped that. In that, his family was involved, and by the direct order of Hitler himself, Dietrich Bonhoeffer was hanged 2 weeks before Hitler killed himself. He almost survived some excruciating things, years of horrible circumstances in prisons and everything like that. And you see, the merchants of the earth and the kings of the earth, they want to take control of God's people. They can't eliminate them like the communists did. You know, they tore down the churches. The same thing that ISIS is doing over there, tearing down these historic churches, hundreds of years old, tearing them down, want to remove any vestiges that would show that there were ever any believers in Jesus out there. And so here it says, the kings of the earth that committed acts of immorality with her, and merchants of the earth have become rich by the wealth of her sensuality. I love pointing out a few years ago when I was involved in Southern Baptist churches and also was knowledgeable about what was going on, that Southern Baptist churches pay more money on interest on loans for buildings and programs they have going on than they give to missions around the world. And see, that's part of how the merchants of the earth become rich by the wealth of her fleshliness. And then comes this, verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come, now listen, come out of her, my people. When I tell you that God's people are in every one of these churches out there, folks, I really believe the Bible says that it's so. And it says so in symbolic language in several places where God's sheep are scattered on all the dusky mountains. You know what dusky mountains are? Mountains are high places. They're places of worship. Dusky mountains means they don't have much light. They've all got a little bit of light. They've all got a little bit of truth. And they sandwich it between, you know, in between these bits of truth, they sandwich some lies in there. And you have to have discernment to recognize that. God's people are out there. And listen to what he says about this church, this wicked church. Come out of her, my people, that you may not, listen, participate in her sins, and that you may not receive of her plagues. For her sins have piled up as high as heaven, and God has remembered their iniquities. Pay her back. Even as she is paid, give her back double according to her deeds. And the cup which she has mixed, mix twice as much for her. And listen to what this church was doing. Verse 7. You want to be sure your church is not doing these things. Because this passage could be describing your church or my church. To the degree that she glorified herself. You know any churches that brag about themselves and how important they are? How great they are? To the degree that this woman, this church, glorified herself and lived sensuously, to the same degree give her torment and mourning. For she says in her heart, I sit as queen. Why is she queen? Oh, I'm married to King Jesus. I sit as queen. I'm his bride. I'm not a widow. I have a husband. My husband is Jesus. And I'm never going to see mourning. For this reason, in one day her plagues will come, pestilence, mourning, famine, and she'll be burned up with fire, for the Lord who judges her is strong. And the kings of the earth who committed acts of immorality and lived sensuously with her will weep and lament over her when they see the smoke of her burning, standing at a distance. Woe, woe, the great city Babylon. You know, there are a lot of people who want to label certain groups or certain churches as Babylon that's talked about in Revelation. I believe there's a mistake that's been made about that. We had a fellow who came into one of our meetings in Colorado. Had never seen him before, never saw him again. He walked in the door and said, I'm here to tell you that the Catholic Church is the harlot Babylon church in Revelation. And walked out. I'm like, hang on, buddy. I don't disagree with that. But I was raised Baptist, and I can tell you there are Baptist churches that are part of that Babylon thing too. And there are charismatic churches that are part of that. And there are assembly churches, and there are Presbyterian churches, and there are Episcopal churches, and there are all kinds when you see what the Bible describes that these harlot churches are doing. My opinion is when you think about one world church, you know, that in the last times there's going to be this one world church. Can I give you my opinion? This is an opinion alert. Opinion alert. My opinion is that what Revelation is describing is the world in the church. Not one church around the world. The world has moved into the church. I remember hearing a Baptist leader some time ago say, in my lifetime, the devil has moved from the back row in the Baptist church to the front row, and sometimes he's standing in the pulpit. And I'm not beating up on Baptists. I'm just saying Baptists are not exempt. Neither is our church where I'm a pastor. Okay? Neither is our church. It depends on the fruit and what's going on. Yes, ma'am.
Isn't that part of the effect of the whole ecumenism movement?
Yes.
Joining of all the churches. Right.
And see, Jesus wants us to be united. But it's not unity at any cost.
Right.
And what I've found is the real unity that God is going to bring is not forgetting about the virgin birth and saying that doesn't matter, or not forgetting the divinity of Christ saying that doesn't matter, or that God is three and yet he's only one God, that we forget about that, and therefore, you know, or like the Lutheran bishop in Sweden that had all the crosses removed out of the church here this last year so it wouldn't offend the Muslims. And of course, you probably heard that she's also the Lutheran lesbian bishop in Sweden was taking all that. See, compromise at any, just peace at any cost is not what the Bible teaches. The unity is in the Word. And the unity is that we may not see everything exactly the same way, and that's okay, because we're going to keep searching for truth, and we're going to make Jesus Christ Lord, and we're not going to compromise what we know to be true. But the other things, if you don't want to drink wine, that's okay, but don't tell me I'm going to hell because I do. If you want to worship on the Sabbath on Saturday, that's okay, but don't tell me that it's the mark of the beast that I gather with people and worship on Sunday. I would gather with them every day. But you know what? Some folks have to work for a living. So we set aside a time. We set aside a time when it's most convenient the majority of us can get together. But you see, that's the kind of divisive thing. Have as your own conviction, that's fine. But don't spew judgment on and be divisive about things that are a matter of your own conscience. And if you believe you shouldn't eat meat, more power to you. I wouldn't throw a steak at you because of that. Follow what the Lord is convicting you to do. You want to follow the dietary laws? Do that. My wife and I went down that pathway for a while. And then we came to some conclusions. The Lord said, don't be in bondage to that. All things are clean. But don't be in bondage. And yet at the same time, don't give offense either. When it can be avoided, we want to do that. So God's people were in this church. But he was warning them, the time is coming when you must come out, so that you don't become a sharer in her sins. All right. Enough of that. Let's look at one more. John 11. John chapter 11, you may recognize this. This is the passage that describes the friend of Jesus, Lazarus, who had two sisters, Mary and Martha. They lived in Bethany, right outside of Jerusalem. You remember that there was a little sibling rivalry going on, and Martha complained one time, I'm in the kitchen doing all this work. My sister's sitting out here. Tell her to help me. And Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you're worried and bothered about so many things. Only a few things are necessary. Really? Only one. And what Mary was doing, sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to his word, he said, it'll never be taken away. That's the one thing that's absolutely necessary. So later on, their brother dies. And in verse 3 it says, the sisters sent to Jesus saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. And when Jesus heard it, this is what he says. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified. By the way, did Lazarus die? You can wag your head. Oh, yes, 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 he did. Remember when Jesus came? The sisters came to meet him and said, if you'd have been here, you wouldn't have died, Jesus. And Jesus said, roll the stone. And she objected. And I love how she objects in the King James. Lord, he stinketh. Lord, he stinketh. The body was already beginning to decay. The point that I want you to see here is that Jesus said, this is not a sickness unto death, but God's going to get some great glory with what's about to happen here in the next few days. But we can turn that back around saying, oh, Jesus said to Lazarus, this is not a sickness unto death. Jesus, does that mean that there could be a sickness, that it's in God's plan because it's somebody's time to die? That's what's being inferred right here. But let's go see for sure in 2 Kings 13. When Elisha, remember there was Elijah, and his protege was Elisha. Elisha became sick with the illness of which he was to die. Well, why don't you lay hands on and pray for him and he'll get well? Don't do that because it's time for him to die. One of the men that God used a century ago or so did amazing, phenomenal things through to demonstrate his power as a man named Smith Wigglesworth. He came to the Lord a little bit later on in life and God really connected with him. And in fact, I think it was in Sweden where they've abandoned Christianity, but back then they wanted to keep him from coming anymore because so many sick people were getting well. And so they said, we'll let you come teach. I could be mistaken, it might have been Holland, but they said, we're going to let you come teach, just don't go out among the people. And so he stood up on a podium. They made sure that there were guards between him and the people so he couldn't get out among the people. And he taught them the word, and he said, now they won't let me come out and lay hands on you, but lay hands on each other, and thousands of people got well. Well, his wife became sick. He's back in England. His wife becomes sick, and she dies. And they're holding a wake. And when he gets there, he comes in. And he commands her to come back to life in the name of Jesus. There was a group, I believe there was a group like 12 or 14 people that were present. And she sat up and she looked at her husband and said, Smith, what are you doing? He said, you're alive, you're back. She said, it's time for me to go, leave me alone. And she laid back down and she died. I'm telling you, God has a sense of humor. We get all worried about this thing about dying and all that. Get over it. Jesus conquered death for us. And if it's a sickness unto death, then leave the person alone. Let them go in peace. In the case of my father-in-law, we gathered around and we prayed and said, and we told him, Ed, it's okay. You can go. He would have been really miserable if he had been bedridden for a year or 2 years. He was a very active guy. Worked his whole life. Never got to play sports here in Florence. His dad thought that was a waste of time. He had to get home and get out in the fields, chasing water, chopping cotton when he lived over here at Valley Farms. And he was still going to work a month before he passed. Now he was really young. And he's looking younger than me all the time. He was only 74. But my father, I came home from work one night in Casa Grande and I said something about some of my sons wanting to go see my dad, and my mom was in the kitchen. She turned and looked at him and said, we need to go right now. He was at a VA nursing home in Tucson. Well, I'd been out working late the night before on water damage and stuff, and I'm like, okay, so let me get a shower. So I got a shower, we got down there, and my dad, doing just the opposite of Lynn's dad, because we were present when he breathed his last. But he was like he was running a race. And some of you know, I mentioned that my dad was a world-class runner and was in Olympic trials in the 50s and stuff. And it was like he was running. He was breathing really fast. Deep kind of breath like that. And he was lying on his bed there. And Mom and I stood there and we prayed for him. We said, Dad, it's okay. It's okay. You can go. Mom's going to be fine. Lord's going to take care of her. We're going to take care of her. And within 15 minutes, he was gone. He was just breathing. That was it. He was gone. And his ailments, and Ed's ailments, were a sickness unto death. It was time for him to go. My dad made 80 and a half years, which is amazing for a guy who had his arm shot off 61 years earlier. But he made it to my mom and dad's 60th wedding anniversary. You know, he was really blessed. 16 grandkids, 14 grandsons, and 2 granddaughters, and great-grandkids, and he was blessed. In this case, it was time for Elisha, you say it right, to die. And he became sick and he died. On down in verse 20, and Elisha died. Huh, how about that? It was a sickness unto death. And they buried him. By the way, twice as many miracles were performed at the hands of Elisha, as were performed at the hands of Elijah, just as he had requested. He said, give me a double portion of your spirit. And he said, you be there when I am taken up, Elijah said, and your request will be granted. But when it came time to die, there was no healing for him, nor was it sought. It was time to go. And they buried him. But here's the part that cracks me up, and I want to share with you before we take it. This is so cool. I'm telling you, stuff like this in the Bible, and I can just hear Jesus laughing. This is awesome. Okay. So, now the bands of the Moabites would invade the land in the spring of the year. It's kind of like, okay, nice warm days. Let's go invade our enemies, the Israelites. Okay? And so as they were burying a man, behold, they saw a marauding band, and they cast the man into the grave of Elisha. And when the man touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and stood up on his feet. Where are you guys burying me? What is going on? The power of God was so great it even still resided in his bones. And the man revived and stood up. I don't know how the marauding bands are coming down. The guy comes out of the tombs and he's wrapped up saying, hey boys, got anything to eat? I'm hungry. I don't know what happened. We don't have the details of the rest of it, but I would love to have been a fly on the cave and the wall right there. This ninth reason that people are sick is sort of akin to sharing in the sins of others, but it's different enough that we identified it as a ninth cause, and that is what we call a corporate sin. 1 Samuel, there's Joshua and Judges, the story of Ruth. 1 and 2 Samuel, and the other twins come behind. Okay. Is that right? How about that?
He's 4.
You got a twin? 4 minutes older. By the way, one of the things that I didn't tell you, which was really interesting, Lynn's father was at home, at their home on Grand Street, which is near Country Club University in Mesa, where they've lived for, since 1971. He took his last breath at the same minute that Lynn had been born 53 years early.
Awesome.
Same minute. Interesting, isn't it? Makes you wonder. Somebody told me this week about their mother passing. Their father worked a regular job, and he always walked through the door just a minute or two after 5 o'clock. And it was that minute or two after 5 when her mother breathed her last. It's kind of like, Dad's home. I'm free to go now. Before we get away, we do want to pray for our sister Pamela. You know, her sister Deborah that received Jesus just a week ago Saturday. She died yesterday, which was Pam's birthday. It's interesting how these intersections happen. But Pamela related to me this way last night. I went over and prayed for her when she sent me a text. And she said, you know, my sister and I had a kind of a tumultuous relationship, and it was her way of having the last word by dying on my birthday. That's what she said. She did. She said it with a smile. She had the last word. And her sister was battling cancer, but she just received Jesus a week ago Saturday. And we prayed for her and asked for the Lord to heal her. And as someone said to me once, a man we prayed for that died, she said, well, God completely healed him this time. Because his battle is over. So it turned out to be a sickness unto death. Sometimes we can discern that. God's not obligated to tell us, but we just need to understand there are different reasons. And you know, if you're battling the sickness, you can start asking the Lord, what's the reason here? We need to get past this thing of trying to get sympathy and feeling sorry for ourselves. And Becky, you know, that's just wonderful, the attitude that God's given you. When she was stricken with MS, she said, you know, people were telling her how they feel sorry. And she said, don't feel sorry for me. She said, sometimes you have to get flat on your back so that God can get you to look up. It's kind of hard to look anywhere else when you're flat on your back. But by the way, part of why you're still here with us is because she was determined to stand against us and fight it. Many others that she's known with MS through the years have passed on. And in a lot of cases, they just gave up. And I know that that was that was Pamela's concern about her sister Deborah. When she had to move out of the house she was losing, we were moving her into Caliente, and we brought our trucks from work and the guys, and they were supposed to have everything packed up so we could just load the trucks and move it. And that usually doesn't happen that way, and it didn't. But she just really become passive. She sat there and did nothing. And you know, a lot of what the Lord does in us is determined by what's in our heart. And how many people have you encountered that will give a testimony that says, the doctor said I'll never walk. I was determined I was going to walk, and I cried out to God, and now I'm walking, and the doctor said that I never would. And it wasn't that the doctors were trying to curse them or anything. It's just saying medically, you know, you may never walk again. But that determination, you know, God has given amazing healing power physically to our bodies. Irrespective of a relationship with God, He's just built it in our bodies to be able to fight disease and sickness, an amazing ability to heal. But when you couple the power of the Holy Spirit and what Jesus did by His wounds, we're healed. What He did for us, it multiplies the healing power that God puts in the body. And it's awesome when we do what He says to do, which is to lay hands on the sick and pray. And we watch God do the most amazing things. Well, meanwhile, 1 Samuel 5. Now the hand of the Lord was very heavy on the Ashdodites, and He ravaged them and smote them with tumors, both Ashdod and its territories. And what had happened is they stole the Ark of the Covenant of God. They thought it was going to be a good luck charm. And it winds up cursing them, and these tumors are breaking out on all the residents. Were all the residents personally involved in going and stealing the Ark of the Covenant of God? No. But the community leadership was. Oh, and there's a really funny thing in there. Gosh, we'd be here all night laughing at some of these things. But they took the Ark of the Covenant, set it next to their pagan god. Okay, in verse 2, they brought it into the house of Dagon and set it. And they rose early the next morning, and Dagon had fallen on his face to the ground before the Ark of God. So they took their idol and they propped it back up. And when they arose the next morning, he had fallen on his face. And the head had been chopped off, and the palms of his hands were gone. And then tumors start breaking out on everybody in the city. Were they all personally involved in this? No. But by their association as being members of the same community, we have corporate sin that caused them to break out with tumors. Another illustration over in Genesis 12:17. It just helps us to see. Now you say, well, that was an exceptional thing. Well, the thing with Job was exceptional. But remember, God is no respecter of persons, and what happened in Job's case could be happening in your case. Especially if you're righteous and fearing the Lord and turning away from evil just like Job was. There might be something happen like that. Well, I don't want to be righteous and godly. Wait a minute, before you make that decision, you need to look at the benefits. The benefits were that he was abundantly blessed. And God only made an exception to make a point with Satan. It's the only reason that he was allowed to touch him. We're over Genesis 12, down to verse 17. But you remember the Lord struck Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. Now, you talk about an interesting story. Oh, my goodness. Can't go there tonight, but I'm telling you, there's buried treasure in here, and there are all kinds of trails that we could go chase down. Well, let me just tell you what happened here. Very strange moral code in the land of Egypt. A man would never take another man's wife. But if he killed the man, she's a widow, and then he can take her. Go figure. Makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? And so Abraham, being a coward and being fearful and not being full of faith and not trusting God, says to his wife, they're going to see how beautiful you are, and they're going to kill me to take you. So tell them that you're my sister. And that's what he did. And Pharaoh says, hey, she's going to join my harem, and she's going through all this process. What's going on in Sarah's mind? Her heart was broken. Well, you big weenie.
did.
You coward! You can't trust God for this and you want me to lie? And it grieved her heart, but that's what she did. But God spared her. And what happened is that all of a sudden his whole household are getting these plagues. And Pharaoh was smart enough to have discernment. In verse 18 says, what is this you've done to me? Why did you not tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she's my sister? Take her and go away. And when they left, by the way, the plagues were lifted off. You go back and read verse number 16. It's where Achan sinned, and his whole family, children, possessions, everything, were stoned with stones and killed because of the sin of the father. We do have an impact on one another. So those are 9 reasons that we know of. I remind you again, there are probably more. I can pretty much guarantee you that there are more. But that's how many we know of. That's how many I can take you to and show you. I want you to see what the Bible says the source of healing is. We're just going to see this as a little survey, and then we're going to come back. We have a few more weeks that we can dig into this and try to gain some more insight and understanding. Book of James, remember, go to Revelation, turn left, and you go across to Little John's and Peter, and you'll come to James chapter 5. Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith might restore. Does your Bible say might?
Will.
I already saw some heads wagging going, no. Notice what he says. James is pretty emphatic. You know, this is the James who's the half-brother of Jesus. He's one of the brothers of Jesus that are named in Scripture. Mary was his mother, but Joseph most likely was his father, because it doesn't tell us that Mary remarried once Joseph had passed. The prayer offered in faith will restore the one who's sick. And the Lord will raise him up. It doesn't say Rick will raise him up. It doesn't say the faith healer will raise him up. It doesn't say, some incantation or, some procedure you go through will raise him up. The Lord will raise him up. And by the way, if he's committed sins, they will be forgiven him. Why did you throw that in there, James? Because even though there are at least 9 different reasons for sickness, sin, personal sin, is one of the biggies. And so that's why he brings that out. If there's sin involved in this person's sickness, their sins will be forgiven them. I want you to see who the healer is here. It's not the elders. It's not the oil. It is God. God, the Lord, God, Jehovah, will raise him up.
So yes, by this act, the Lord is all forgiven.
Exactly.
Okay.
Which kind of ties back to that other thing we've been looking at. Yeah.
I mean,
so, mm-hmm, yeah, it kind of connects back to that. Therefore, by the way, he goes on, he says, therefore, do it. Here's what he says. Confess your sins to one another, pray for one another, so that you may be healed. And then he says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. I like King James, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. So it says something about praying for the sick when people are in tune with the Lord. That's what's so powerful when we have a gathering like we have here and we lay hands on and pray for somebody, because our hearts are set on the Lord. We've been in His Word. We've been tuned in with God. And the presence of the Lord is going to be there. He always comes to teach us His Word and to plant it deep in the soil of our heart so that it can produce Jesus in us. And so that's why it's so, so important for people that are sick to come be in Bible study for a while, and then we pray for the sick and they get well. And like I've told you in testimonies, we've had a number of times where we've been doing a week-long Bible conference and people get healed just sitting there in the chair. We don't get to lay hands on them or anything. Notice, this is not the only instruction that we have for praying for the sick. This is just one of several. But we can learn a lot from this, and we're going to come back to it at another time. But now let's go to John 14, Big John. Jesus makes this astonishing statement here in John chapter 14. You have the red letter edition. You'll see it's in red because Jesus is speaking here. John 14:12. Are you there? Got it? Truly, truly, I say to you. Boy, you know, when Jesus is really trying to get their attention and our attention, he makes a statement like, truly, truly. King James says, verily, verily. I'm really serious about this. Pay attention to this. This is important. It's life for you. He who believes in me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to the Father. See, but Jesus is the Son of God. Yes, but the thing he kept reminding everyone was, and the name he most frequently used in reference to himself was, Son of Man. Yes, I'm the Son of God. I am God in the flesh. But I was born, and I had to grow up, and I had to learn to do right, and I had to learn to walk with God, and I had to learn the Scripture exactly like you do. By the way, you can see Peter, one of the things we were observing the other day, we were talking about, nowhere in the Bible does it say Jesus, his shadow came across people and they were healed. But in Acts, Peter's walking down the street, they're dragging sick people out, and his shadow's crossing people and they're getting healed. That's some of the greater works. We're to do what Jesus did. Did Jesus heal the sick? Yeah, he did. Did Jesus preach to people, repent, turn to God with all your heart? Yeah, well, that, if we believe in him, he says, we're going to do that too. Look down at, what was the next verse? 21, yeah. He who has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him. And get this, I will disclose myself to him. Wow! Jesus is the key to showing us who God is and in having this encounter so that we can receive of the power of God for living here just like Jesus had. And that's why the mythological view that many people have and many of us may still be holding to about Jesus has to be thrown away. Jesus said, live like I live. And he would not instruct us to do that unless he would also empower us and give us the opportunity to do it. He's not dangling a carrot out there, something which cannot happen. He tells us to live like me because that's what he expects his people to do. And indeed, if we're yielded to the Holy Spirit of God to work through us, that is what is going to happen. Praise the Lord. Acts 10. You know what? We've seen that a number of times. Go to Psalm 103. Paul's preaching, he said, you know of Jesus, Peter's preaching, you know of Jesus of Nazareth, whom God anointed with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all those who were oppressed by the devil. Who's doing the healing? Jesus. Is Rick doing the healing? Nope. Are you doing the healing? Nope. Is our church doing the healing? Nope. Is some priest doing the healing? Nope. There's some special prayer that you pray that's magical and just makes it happen? No, it's God. So the whole key is connecting with God, connecting with Jesus. Jesus went about healing all those oppressed by the devil. Does that mean every sickness and every disease that comes is ministered by Satan? Well, it sure sounds like it from Acts 10:38. Okay, now we're to Psalm 103. I love Psalm 103. I've quoted Acts 10 so many times, that's why I didn't have you turn there. Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. I've heard that scripture dozens and dozens of times in church meetings, in denominational meetings, in preacher gatherings. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits. And I think I was in my late 30s before I ever heard what the rest of that said. Hence, I can't blame the guys who stopped quoting there because they didn't believe the next part. Because it was there for me to read. Here's what the next part says. Who pardons all your iniquities, who heals small, simple sicknesses, but not really big diseases. No, that's not what it says. Do you realize that all over this Bible, God's in the healing business? He loves to heal his people. But he wants us to meet his conditions in order to tap into that. Forget none of his benefits. He forgives us of our iniquities and sins, and he heals all your diseases. All of them. You see, the problem has been, I've illustrated this a few times, let me just mention it again. You see, we look at what the Bible says right up here. You consider all that God says that we're to do. We're to walk in joy and peace and overcome sin and forgive all those who've ever wronged us and bless those who curse us. And we're living up here. And when we're sick, we pray for the sick and they get well. And then we come down through the years and teachers and leaders look, and this is where the people are living down here. They walk, talk, and act like the devil and everything. And rather than saying, repent and let's live up here, they start explaining all of these things away. And after all, God understands you're only human. You're nothing but a bunch of dirt, and you're sinful, worthless, and rotten, and everything. And God loves you anyway. And when He looks at you, He doesn't see your sin. He just sees the blood of Jesus. You ask Jesus into your heart and receive forgiveness through His blood. And so now you walk, talk, act like the devil, and go to heaven. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible's calling us up here. And you know what we have to do? Let's quit explaining these things away to make people comfortable right here. And if people are uncomfortable, tough cookies. Okay? Let God be true even if every man's a liar. This is where God says we're to live. And He says way back here in Psalms, and this is a Psalm of David, who heals all your diseases. Golly, David thought that God was in the healing business. How about that? Exodus 15. Exodus 15. Again, I mentioned this is just a real quick overview of some key scriptures that give us the general information about God being healer. And it's not something new that's been, that Jesus came along and introduced, hadn't been there before. It's been there all along, and it continues to be so, even though men write thick books to say that it isn't so. Exodus 15, verse 22. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out in the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days in the wilderness, and they found no water. And so, they're a little bit despondent, a little unhappy. And down at verse 26, he says, if you will give earnest heed, verse 26, to the voice of the Lord your God, do what's right in His sight, give ear to His commandments, keep His statutes. Listen to what God says. I will put none of the diseases on you which I have put on the Egyptians, for I, the Lord, am your healer. Get to know God. He said, He put the diseases, those sicknesses and diseases on the Egyptian people. Why? Because of their wickedness and ungodliness. Just like He said He would. You see, it wasn't just for Israel in Deuteronomy 28 and Leviticus 26. It's for all mankind. He says, I won't put any of these diseases on you. God says He did it. But wait a minute. If that's true, then why did Jesus heal all those oppressed by the devil? I'm glad you asked that question. Come back for a further study and maybe you'll understand a little bit better about how God is absolutely God Almighty and Satan can only do what God allows him and in many cases sends him to do. And some of that sickness came on Hezekiah, but he repented and God healed him. And it came on Asa and he hardened his heart and he died. Where does that leave you and me? We're in the same boat. You need to repent, get your heart tuned in with the Lord. Go to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 7. I, the Lord, am your healer. How about that? Some formula is not your healer. Do you understand why I keep saying that? It's the same reason why I make the point that there is no power in prayer. It's kind of splitting hairs, but I think it's really important. There is no power in prayer. The power's in God. Prayer is the vehicle God has chosen by which we connect with Him so that His power can come to work in our behalf. You say, well, it's just semantics. No, it's more than that, because there are a lot of people who have faith in their faith and they have faith in their words. Our faith must be in the Lord Jesus Christ. And if anything's going to happen, it's by the power of His Holy Spirit. And His Holy Spirit takes this word, which is His sword, and He does warfare with the enemy. And that's why we quote the word of God against the enemy and against sickness and disease. Because we're connecting with God, but it's not our praying. There's no power in our praying. But God gave us this wonderful method by which we can take hold of His hand and His Spirit. And it's through praying. The power is in God. And that's why all the glory goes to Him. None of it goes to us. Wow, I'm a great prayer. I prayed and somebody who had cancer got well. No. Prayer has no power. God is great, and he lets us connect with this thing called praying, and he comes and he physiologically changes conditions in people's bodies, and it's awesome. I love seeing it. I love getting in on it. I love experiencing it personally. When he fixed my heart some years ago, I was having a heart problem. Praise the Lord. People prayed, the Lord healed me, and it tried to come back on me, but I stood against it when he healed me of a kidney stone. I said, no, Rick, you go and you have that removed. Let me tell you, we just need to connect with God and just see what he does. He does amazing things. Deuteronomy 7. Am I in the right place? Okay.
Yeah.
Getting excited to get carried away here right before quitting time. Verse 12. Then it'll come about, because you listen to these judgments and keep and do them, that the Lord your God will keep with you his covenant and his loving kindness, which he swore to your forefathers. And then down to verse 14. You shall be blessed above all peoples. There shall be no male or female barren among you or among your cattle. What about kitty cats and dogs? Your cats and dogs, your chickens, your turkeys, your sheep. You see, the blessings on Job were extended to his property and his children. And the Lord will remove from you all sickness, and he will not put on you any of the harmful diseases of Egypt, which you have known. That's how I know on the Passover night when they came out of Egypt, God healed them of their sicknesses and diseases, which is a picture of the fullness of salvation that Jesus purchased for us. The blood of Jesus washes away our sin. I don't care how heinous or hideous your sin may have been. Maybe you had an abortion. Maybe you were involved in rape. Maybe you killed somebody or were a participant in that. I'm telling you, whatever it was, if you repent with your whole heart, the blood of Jesus is strong enough to cleanse you of all of that. And by the wounds of Jesus, he purchased for us physical healing. And we can have that. He offers that to us freely if we'll meet his conditions. If we'll come to him with a whole heart and with a willing mind. And he said, I'm not going to put any of these diseases on you that you used to know. I'm going to lay it on all those who hate you. That's why we need to pray for our enemies, that they'll repent and not be our enemies. Because you're walking with God and somebody is being wicked, hateful, and ungodly to you, the Lord may take them out. I don't want anybody who's wronged me to be taken out because of what they did for me. I pray that God will forgive them and grant them repentance, because I want those that I've wronged to forgive me likewise. Yes, sir.
I was just sitting here thinking about what I was taught. I've been in the church for 50 years, and I asked two or three preachers why the scriptures talk about God putting illness on people and asking them to kill all the babies and all this, you know.
Yeah.
And I was told, I don't know, probably two or three times, that the reason that it says that in here is because they weren't real smart yet.
Yeah, right.
And they thought everything came from God.
Right.
And that
they're big, thick books to explain that.
Yeah.
And the same thing about Jesus casting out demons. Jesus was just humoring the people because they thought that was the source of sickness.
It makes you angry to think that somebody,
yeah,
like the word said,
yeah,
and they really believed that they were helping God's reputation.
Yeah. Right.
So, I mean,
see, that's also one of the motives for saying, these are Old Testament books, let's throw those away.
Yeah.
Because it's very clear what God did back there. But now that's all changed. God's just a loving God. Baloney. God has always been a loving God. He's always been merciful. He has never changed.
He would not change.
But he sends judgment on the wicked and the ungodly. And if that's me, he'll send it on me. And if that's you, he'll send it on you. And that's why we need to repent and get connected with him. Because God's no respecter of persons. But I go to church all the time. Doesn't matter. If you're evil and wicked, God will send judgment on you. Standing in the pulpit or wherever. Praise the Lord. But yes, that's the kind of explanation man gives. So that,
well, it's the same. They use the same one about healing. That, you know, by saying that God didn't heal anymore, Jesus didn't heal anymore, they were helping his reputation.
Yeah, we don't want him to look too...
When it didn't happen.
Right, we don't want him to look too bad. We're going to help Jesus out. Yeah, I used to have those thoughts too. And I found out God doesn't care if I look bad at all. He doesn't care at all if I look bad.
Who knew?
Who knew? But that's a good point. And see, words of men diluting the word of God.
Yeah.
And that's why I keep saying, let God be true, and even if every man's a liar. Because, folks, this is true. Do you realize all that God has gone through to preserve for you and me what we're reading here tonight? I mean, some of the most powerful political machines in the world have tried to stamp this out.
Amen.
One of the things that you say that has really helped me is you talk about God Almighty. And somehow that statement makes this just what it is. But when you go and talk to somebody about what it says, well, people were just ignorant then. They didn't know what we know now.
Yeah.
You know, they aren't enlightened, so to speak. Yeah. But I feel sorry for the congregations that are sitting in there.
Amen.
And you can see there's a human proclivity for this thing to make ourselves feel better about us by demeaning those in the past, you know. That's why, you know, these present generations are always talking about how horrible life was in America in the 50s. Well, there were a lot of things that were horrible in the 50s. But let me tell you what. Kids didn't murder each other at schools.
Right. Yeah.
You know what? There were some things that were good, too.
Yeah.
And yet the current generation likes to go and reinterpret all those things to make, you know, we're the most enlightened and wise. And it's a bunch of baloney. And the same thing spiritually goes on, that we're so much more superior to these people. You know, these Israelites, they're a bunch of idiots. No, they're people like us right here, did stupid things. But God was patient and drew us onward and forward with Him. And so He said, the Lord will remove all the sickness. And He won't put those diseases back on. By the way, I have mentioned, I won't go into it again tonight, we have had 3 or 4 experiences of praying for people that weren't able to have children, couples, all of whom have kids now. 2 of those paid the thousands of dollars for in vitro, and the medical field said, you're not able to have kids. One of the ladies, her husband was a Mesa police officer, and we were having Bible study at their house, and we prayed for the curse to be broken, because it's one of the curses, it's barrenness. And within a month or so, she was expecting. And then they said, oh, there's some problems, and they were going to do fetal surgery. And I don't remember, Lynn, if you remember what the problem was with the baby. But have some of you heard of fetal surgeries before?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So, this is where they're actually going in because there was something, you know, something wrong with the baby's organs or something.
Spina bifida is one of the things.
And we laid hands on and prayed for her. And I think the ladies even laid their hands right on her belly where she was pregnant. And we prayed. And 2 days later, they were getting ready to do the surgery. They said, let's check one more time. And the baby was perfectly fine. So God healed them, not only gave them the ability to conceive, but also healed the baby in the womb, and they wound up with 2 or 3 kids. Last I knew, any of you in Cody, Wyoming, check and see ask who the detective is in Cody, Wyoming, and see if he used to be a Mesa cop. And if so, that's him, and his kids would be up there by now. And of course, you know, I've told you the story about our grandson, Caleb, and you know, he had his 10th birthday this year, 11th birthday. Was it 11? Caleb corrected me last week.
No, Jonah did. Or Jonah back there.
Jonah corrected me about his brother Caleb's birthday. All right, look, real quick, go to Jeremiah and we'll be done here for this evening. Are you seeing, are you getting the idea that the Bible says the healing's in Jesus? Mm-hmm. It's not in me, it's not in you. But He does give that to us as His body. That's part of what He does. But He's the one that does the healing. Jeremiah chapter 6. Jeremiah, sorry, y'all. This is the last scripture under the subheading of God is healing. Isaiah, Jeremiah, who wrote Lamentations. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 5. Arise, let us attack by night and destroy her palaces, for thus says the Lord of hosts. cut down her trees, cast up a siege against Jerusalem. This is the city to be punished, in whose midst there is only oppression. As a well keeps its waters fresh, so she keeps fresh her wickedness. Violence and destruction are heard in her. Listen, sickness and wounds are ever before me. Jerusalem was a physical city. God's people dwelt there. It is a type. It is a picture. It's analogous to the church. And this is what's going on in the churches today. And do you notice how with disdain God says, sickness and wounds are ever before me. He's not happy about that, because he has made provision for his people to be well. Look in Jeremiah 8 now. Jeremiah 8 verse 4, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord, do men fall and not get up again? If you realize you've fallen away from God, then get up, dust yourself off, turn to God. Do men fall and not get up? Does one turn away and not repent? Why then is his people Jerusalem, God's people, turned away in continual apostasy? They hold fast to deceit. They refuse to return, that is to repent. I've listened and heard. They've spoken what is not right. No man repented of his wickedness, saying, what have I done? Everyone turned to his course, like a horse charging into battle. Even the stork in the sky knows its seasons. The turtle dove and the swift and the thrush observe the time of their migration. But my people do not know the ordinance of the Lord. Do you know why there are migratory birds? You guys seen the Cardinals this year yet? Not the football players, the birds. A couple times a year we see Cardinals. I've seen some right by the church over at Queen Valley. We were staying down here on Butte at the 310 house. They used to hang out there all the time. Do you know why the migratory birds are there? The ducks and the geese and all moving north to south, south to north. You know what God? You know why God made migratory birds? He just told us why. Because all of creation is preaching to us the truths of God. He said there's a time to change direction. Repent. There's a time to repent. There's a time to repent. God says, these migratory birds know the time of migration, but my people don't know when it's time to repent. They don't know the ordinance of God. How can we say we're wise? The law of the Lord is with us. And listen to this, and this goes right back to what you said, Joyce, in verse 8. Behold, listen, the lying pen of the scribes has made it, the ordinance of God, has made it into a lie. The wise men are put to shame. They're dismayed, caught. They have rejected the word of God. And what kind of wisdom do they have? He says, therefore, I'm going to give their wives to others, their fields. You know, 1 Corinthians says, it says, you are God's field. He's going to give their fields to new owners. He's going to give them away. Because from the least to the greatest, everyone's greedy for gain. The prophet, even to the priest, everyone practiced his deceit. And in verse 11, they heal the brokenness of the daughter of my people, superficially saying, oh, peace be to you. But there absolutely is no peace. And were they ashamed because of the abominations they've done? They weren't ashamed. They didn't even know how to blush. Therefore, they'll fall among those who fall. At the time of their punishment, they'll be brought down, declares the Lord. And then look, the last couple of verses, verse 17. For behold, I am sending serpents against you, adders for which there is no charm, and they will bite you, declares the Lord. Who's the serpent in Genesis 3? In the garden, it's Satan. Who's the serpent in Luke 10? Satan. When the 70 came back and he said, I've given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions. I'm sending them against you. In verse 18, my sorrow is beyond healing. My heart is faint within me. Behold, listen, the cry of the daughter of my people from a distant land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not within her? Why have they provoked me with graven images and foreign idols? Harvest is past. Summer is ended. And we are not saved. For the brokenness of the daughter of my people, I'm broken and mourn. Dismay has taken hold of me. And concluding tonight with verse 22, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Jesus is the great physician. Why then has not the health of the daughter of my people been restored? God wants his people well. He will use sickness and disease to get a hold of our hearts, but he wants his people to be well. And he provides that for us.